Hey everybody, Dr. Bora here with another exciting week of historical geology lecture. So this week we're going to look at kind of environments and life. Last week we looked at all the different kind of types of life and how they're defined taxonomically. And today we're going to kind of look where everything lives on the planet. And this should help us go back in time, and when we find similar life in the rock record, it can allow us to determine what sort of environments life at that time were experiencing, and this will kind of help us put together a bigger picture of what the Earth looked like historically. So the guiding questions for today's lecture are: what factors determine the ecological niches of species, and by what means of species, or what means do species obtain nutrition? What factors govern the geographic distribution of species, and what factors govern the distribution of aquatic life? So the Earth is very dynamic. There's a lot of feedback loops, there's a lot of currents, life is migrating, life is changing, life is evolving, the planet is evolving geographically, the plates are moving, and this kind of has happened now for 4.6 billion years, and during that time life has become more complex, as so has the geology. So ecology is the study of the factors that govern the distribution and abundance of organisms in natural environments. So ecology is studying what controls where things live, and what controls how abundant those populations of things are. Habitats are environments on or close to its surface that is inhabited by life. So a habitat can have, you know, that's the general definition, and there can be hundreds of different types of habitats, all with different, organisms and populations and everything. And this includes both terrestrial and aquatic. And for the aquatic sector, we have marine and freshwater. So earlier I said the word niche, or some people say niche, It's debated on how it's supposed to be said. I've heard niche, and so that's how I say it. I don't know, I'm sure other people think that sounds funny, but I don't really care, because I sound funny a lot of the time. So a niche is the way a species relates to its environment, and this has to do with food, nutrients, and physical and chemical conditions. And that means that certain environments with the right food, nutrients, and chemical conditions and physical conditions may only lead to being inhabited by one organism or something. So the organism would say to have a niche in that kind of environment, right? Life habitat. So this is the way the species lives within its niche. Habitat. And then there's some limiting factors on these niches, especially when it comes to how much food and energy or energy an organism is able to acquire, and then also how much competition there is for that food and energy. So high competition usually leads to diversity, and low competition usually leads to overpopulation. And this is why predation can be good, because if you start getting low competition and low predation, then all of a sudden you have population explosions, and these can lead to overgrazing or, you know, overeating or whatever, and all of a sudden then there's no food left for that creature, and so they've actually eaten themselves out of a place to live, and a lot of times that's where you see mass die-offs and stuff. So ecosystem is the organisms of a community and the physical environment they occupy, and population is a group of individuals inside of that ecosystem, and usually limited to one particular area. And And so ecological community, there's several populations of species living in a similar habitat. And in these communities, you usually have two types of organisms. You have producers and consumers. Producers are things that photosynthesize. And they're the foundations of all kind of food chains or food nets, or what we're going to talk about here in a second. And consumers, these feed on producers. So herbivores feed on producers, and then carnivores actually feed on other consumers. And humans fit there right there in the middle. We just eat everything. So in the ecosystem, you have a biota made of fauna and flora. Fauna are just the animals and protozoans of an ecosystem, where flora are the plants and plant-like things. So these are basically your producers and consumers. And the food web or food chain is a sequence of consumption for producers to consumers. So down here at the very bottom of the chain, you have some little algae or something that's photosynthesizing to create, you know, nutrients. And then this little crustacean or something is like, oh, that algae is really tasty. It's got, cause it's got all these like sugars and stuff in it and proteins. And I'm going to eat that. So it eats it, gets nutrients. Well, then this fish comes along and eats that. And this bigger fish comes along and eats that. And this otter comes along and eats that. Or maybe the otter just goes straight for the crustacean. So this is just how, you know, this is kind of, I think people probably learned about food chains before. So food web, though, is probably a better way to describe most of how these ecosystems or these communities operate. And it's more complex, so there's a lot of different little ins and outs and feedbacks, and but when it comes right down to it, sunlight is a big input here, and you got to have sunlight and producers to kind of feed these webs. So at any one given level of these food webs or food chains, you may have several species that occupy each level, and there may be all sorts of different relationships in how each level kind of I would say communicates, but kind of how they interact. And then there's some parasites, they feed on living organisms, and scavengers feed on dead organisms. So diversity is the variety of species that live together within a community. In places where it's really difficult to live, we see lower diversity, and that's probably because few organisms have evolved to kind of fit that niche of you know, what it requires to actually survive in a really hostile environment. Whereas in environments where it's easier to live, we tend to see more diversity, such as like the rainforest. You get high diversity there because there's lots of producers, there's lots of water, lots of sunlight, the temperature is nice. So you get a lot of diversity because of that. Predation can also influence the diversity. Heavy predation can reduce diversity, and moderate predation can increase diversity. But too much predation, obviously, can also reduce diversity. So opportunistic species, these are species that specialize in kind of moving into places that where another species has failed or something. So they will take over other habitats. Humans, I guess, could be considered opportunistic species. So the biogeography is how life is distributed on a broad geographic scale. And basically, this is limited by how harsh the environment is. So towards the equator, you get more diversity, and physical and chemical barriers will affect this dispersal, and as you get further from the equator, you'll see less diversity just naturally. So we all live under the blanket of the atmosphere, and it's mostly composed of nitrogen, oxygen, argon, and CO2, where CO2 is very, very low, though, 0.04%, or that's about 400 ppm, parts per million. It goes up and down over time, and right now it's just been going up, and that's not great for us because CO2 traps a lot of solar radiation and warms us up, so which leads to climate change. So the tilt of the Earth affects the solar radiation insulation as well. And essentially, it doesn't matter how far or close we are to the sun, as much as it matters the angle that we're tilted. Okay, so the same amount of solar radiation is going over this circle here. Okay, so the same amount of solar radiation is traveling through that area. We call that flux, all right? The amount of material traveling through a cross-sectional area is flux. And so the flux of sun rays here is the same as here, but because when they hit, they're being spread across a broader geographical area, that solar radiation is less intense. Where here, they're being spread across a much more narrow geographical area. And up here, you also have a wider geographical area for what the sun rays are being broadcast, right? So that means like that's why close to the equator, you get intense sun all year round, because it's always gonna be pretty much the same angle. But as the Earth rotates around the sun, the northern hemisphere is either closer, or the southern hemisphere is closer. So northern hemisphere summers, which is up here, are southern hemisphere winters, and southern hemisphere summers are northern hemisphere winters. So it's always flipped. But you probably learned that in high school. Because the Earth spins, you get the Coriolis effect, which causes air and water masses to be kind of deflected to the right in a clockwise motion in the northern hemisphere and counterclockwise in the southern hemisphere. Atmospheric circulation. So there's a net transport in the atmosphere. Basically, warm air rises up from the equator and then kind of moves its way over to the cool kind of hemisphere, cool poles, and then it cools down and then comes back. And so this creates a kind of these air currents, and combined with that Coriolis effect, you get all sorts of different types of winds, prevailing winds. And so this complex pattern, because of the Coriolis effect, you get these kind of three distinct circulation cells. And these are the trade winds, the westerlies and the easterlies. And where they converge, we call intertropical convergence. And so this also leads to having dry air at certain latitudes, which is where we get deserts in both the northern and southern hemisphere. So the atmosphere also is very good at retaining heat. Solar radiation from the sun is absorbed and turned into heat energy. And different parts of the Earth are better or worse at actually reflecting this heat. So the ocean is the best at absorbing solar radiation. So you only get about 6 to 10% of that solar radiation reflected. Forests will reflect 5 to 30%. And that, you know, it's a pretty wide range. So it just depends on the forest. And then snow and ice actually reflect the most, which makes sense because they're white, so there's nothing to absorb. So they just kind of, it gets all bounced back into space. And so if we're currently melting ice caps due to climate change. And what happens is we're creating more ocean, right? So there's more ocean area. So we're absorbing more solar radiation. So we're heating up because of that. And so that causes that ice and snow to melt faster. So then we absorb more. So it's just kind of this positive feedback loop of heating. So like I said, there, because of these, the way the trade winds are set up and the way that the weather patterns kind of occur because of Coriolis effect and also our convection cells due to heating at the equator and cooling at the poles, you get certain climatic zones. So you get tropical rainforests, desert savannas, temperate forests, and polar tundra in a broad spectrum. There's actually a lot more subcategories to that, but that's kind of your broad spectrum. And so that at the equators where we get all of our tropical rainforests mostly. There's also, and then we get our desert savannas at these two latitudes here. This is where our deserts are. Then we get temperate forests further north of that, and then polar tundra further north of that or south of that. Or I should just say at higher latitudes, as latitudes increase, either north or south. So tropical climates average about 18 to 20 degrees Celsius. That's an average year round, but you do get a lot hotter temperatures than that. So they're warm and wet. And they're because of their warm and wet, they have a lot of vegetation. And they're also getting a higher flux of solar radiation, so these producers can produce more. They can perform photosynthesis at a better rate. So deserts are dry because of trade winds remove the moisture. So because of the way the winds are set up, you actually get pretty dry, deserty areas. And this is about 20 to 30 degrees north and south of the equator. The desert is generally defined as getting less than 25 centimeters of rain a year. And there's little vegetation. This is where you get like your savanna and grasslands. It's too dry to support big trees and forests, basically. There's plenty of flux of sun. There's just not, solar radiation. There's just not enough water. The poles, these are defined by ice sheets and glaciers today. In the past, these ice sheets and glaciers have actually been absent or partially absent. The rate we're going, we'll probably see them absent again within the next 100 years. Glaciers themselves are thick sheets of ice caused by the buildup of many seasons of snow at higher elevations. So snow kind of goes through this transition year by year, whereas it falls as snow and then it turns into this thing called kern, which are basically little ice balls, and then those eventually weld together underneath pressure. And eventually, if you get enough of that built up, that ice will actually start to flow under pressure. And these are present at high latitudes and high elevations. So tundra, this is kind of, you get limited water, the ground is partially frozen. And so this leads to they're not being able to have tall trees because the roots can't penetrate the ground. You get grasses and kind of shrubs and lichens and stuff like that here. And then you also have evergreen coniferous forests. So this is just south of the tundra, kind of like Washington and Canada, and Idaho and Montana and et cetera, et cetera. This is where your spruce, pine, and fir. Now, we also have temperate forests, Mediterranean climates. There's a bunch. I'm not going to go into all of them because you can read about it in the book. But the reason this is important, though, because the climate just kind of controls what lives where, right? And so the climate of any given geographical location today has changed through time. And plate tectonics have changed where geographical locations are located. So using the, you know, geographic biodiversity, we can figure out through time how the plates have moved around, more or less. Some complications to that is that climate can also change with altitude, similar to how it changes latitudinally. So at the base of mountains, you can get deciduous forests and then evergreens on the slopes. And then you get a tundra line, you know, that's where your tree line is, and at the top you can have glaciers. So this can all exist in one little, you know, mountain range. And so that can make it a little difficult when studying the geology to try to figure out where certain plates and stuff were located, latitudinally speaking. But with enough information, we can sort of sort those things out. So mountains also cause a rain shadow effect, where you get prevailing winds with moisture pulling off the ocean, and that moisture gets up to a high enough elevation where it precipitates. And the precipitation leads to a lack of moisture on the far side of the mountain. So, and this is really evident in Washington. So if you ever are in Seattle, you know, it rains all the time. And if you ever drive onto the other side of the Cascades, you all of a sudden find yourself in the central Washington desert. So really, really pronounced rain shadow effect there. You see this in Oregon as well, going from like Portland into Bend or something like that. So the whole Northwest is sort of a giant rain shadow. So you can get seasonal changes in climate. You get like, and this has to do with heat capacity of water. And once you build up enough heat in the water, then all of a sudden you can start having things like monsoons or hurricanes or stuff like that. Climate is the long-term average weather. So weather changes from day to day, but climate is your long-term average weather. And on the long-term average, climate controls what sort of life is there. So plant life is actually very sensitive to changes in climate. I think, cool example of that is how leaf margins look at the tropics versus temperate areas. So if you look at all the species of plants in the tropics and in the and in the temperate climates, you can say what percentage of smooth margin species there are. So this would be a leaf with a smooth margin, this would be a leaf with a jagged margin. And what we find is, based off the average annual temperature, there's a high correlation between the percentage of smooth and margin species. So high average temperature equals high smooth margin. And this has to do with water retention. So a lot of these high temperature species want have low surface area, so they lose less water through transevaporation. And they also a lot of times are waxy to repel water, so they don't become waterlogged. So they want to keep water inside, but repel water from the outside. So also that wax helps keep water in as well. So we see that kind of correlation here. And so if we find fossils, so if we find smooth margin fossils in Antarctica, what does that tell us about Antarctica? That sometime in the past, Antarctica was at a tropical climate. And that could be because it was a lot hotter. And so the poles were experiencing tropical climates, or it could be because Antarctica was located at the equator. And so that's something we have to figure out with some other tools. So in the marine realm, there's also currents, just like there is on land or in the atmosphere. The currents are wind-driven, and they follow kind of the atmospheric patterns. So your trade winds push waters west from equatorial currents. And so these equatorial currents you find here just north or south of the equator. And then there's also equatorial countercurrents, which is the return of that water. So the water will go, will push its way clockwise in the north, okay? And then will push itself counterclockwise in the south. And so a clockwise start of an equatorial current in the south will eventually then get pushed back, and you get these big things called gyres. And these gyres actually create little zones where there's no current. And so you get these actually big zones of the oceans where there's actually a little life because of that. You also have a circumpolar current, and this again has to do with winds pushing water around near the poles. But this causes ocean mixing. And then you have polar circulation, which is where sea ice, the creation of sea ice leads to more saline water due to distillation, right? So if you make ice out of salt water, well, salt doesn't go into the ice as easily. So you actually create leftovers are more saline. And so that creates this kind of cold, dense, saline-rich water. And that saline water goes kind of sinks down because it's cold and dense, and that sinking allows for warmer waters, especially from lower latitudes, to work its way up and upwell. And so that's so you get heat loss. So you kind of get this like circulation, and this kind of recycles the oceans, which is good. But if we lose all the sea ice on the at the poles, then we're going to be left with less circulation. So you also get a few other types of ocean circulation. You have waves. Waves are wind driven, and they break basically when the seafloor meets depth. So if you have like a deep seafloor like this, and the wave's pushing along, and then all of a sudden it hits something a little shallower, then it causes it to push up, and then that's what creates a wave. So, and you also have tides, which is caused by a gravitational attraction of the moon. So big bulges of water basically get pulled from one side of the earth to the other, and this causes in and out tides. And this is a pretty major movement of water, but it helps with, again, with circulation and in kind of recycling the ocean. So at the edges of continents, we have continental shelves, and the shelf break is kind of the edge of that continental shelf where we fall off into the kind of continental rise in the abyssal plain. It's about 200 meters is where we call that break. And this is important because this is the photic zone. This is where, photic zone is where basically photosynthesis is still allowed to occur. So light can still penetrate that depth to allow for photosynthesis to occur. So if we are seeing continental reefs, okay, if we're seeing, big reef shelves of living kind of like coral and stuff, then that tells us that that location was probably somewhere 200 meters or less, and probably near a continental shelf. So that's something about the rock record that can tell us about how ocean levels are changing. Near shore, they have barrier islands and marshes and epicontinental seas. Again, all these are things that if we find in the rock record, tell us a little bit about how the Earth was organized. As I was saying earlier, you have the photic zone, which is the region of ocean where enough light penetrates to permit photosynthesis. You have two types of life. You have pelagic life and benthic life. Pelagic life is life that kind of moves around in the water. Plankton cannot control where they move. They have to move with the currents, so they can't swim against the currents. And then you have phytoplankton and zooplankton. And then nekton are anything that can swim against the current. So nekton's all your kind of megafauna of the oceans. Well, not even megafauna, but fauna of the oceans that can swim against the current. And they're usually, nekton are eating plankton through a whole different various ways. Also phytoplankton are your photosynthesizing plants, whereas zooplankton are consumers. And benthic life are basically bottom feeders and suspension feeders. So in the marine zone, we still have tropical, subtropical, transitional, and subarctic zones. So corals require warm water. They're common in those tropical zones. There's a bunch of things that build coral reefs. And these generally have a symbiotic relationship with algae, so like seaweed and stuff. And then lastly here, for the marine realms, there's different levels of salinity for marine realms. So oceanic, generally, salinity is about 35 parts per thousand. That's pretty dang salty. Brackish actually has lower salinity. This is kind of where you have ocean water meeting with bays or lagoons or freshwater source of some kind. And then hypersaline is where you have higher than marine, and this can occur in really hot and arid climates, and maybe in some kind of inlet oceans and stuff like that, so, or inland seas. Okay, so that was a really quick lecture on kind of where life occurs and the different types of climatic zones we have. So I think that that's enough for one lecture. I probably could have gone into more detail, but I don't want to overwhelm you too much since you have a quiz this week. Good luck on your quizzes. And hopefully this will allow a nice setup for us starting to talk about how life varied historically on the planet and what that can tell us about how the Earth has changed over time. Thanks for watching, as always. Bye.